Hello, everybody. Welcome back to my channel.
The opera. The theater.
We all know that in order to be in the theater, much less an opera, you have to be a little eccentric, very comfortable with yourself. Some might say a little bit flamboyant. Does it hurt? I mean, if you look at some of these attire that operas do, you have to be very comfortable with yourself and a little bit of a me kind of a self, because I'm not wearing this at all. Unless I'm going to a Victorian opera ball, then I will. But the point is, if you haven't guessed, today we are going to talk about an opera singer. I'm gonna have fun with this one, I'm just telling you right now. One who was the topic of much gossip in the aristocratic circles of 17th century France. And in today's terms, considered to be bisexual or queer due to her scandalous relationships with men and women. Julie d'Aubigny. Let's get started. Okay. Since we're going to be in France today, clearly I'm not going to be able to pronounce most of these words, as we learned with Ludmilla. Stethispool. That did not sound right. But I'm going to do my darndest to pronounce these correctly. I have my trusty phone and pronunciation Google thingy on here. But be forewarned, for most of these, the robots are coming back. All right, here we go. Julie d'Aubigny, better known as Mademoiselle
Maupin.
We forgot the other name. Julie d'Aubigny, better known as Mademoiselle Maupin or La Maupin, was born in 1670 or 1673 in Paris, France. Yeah, we're going back this far. She was the only child to Gaston d'Aubigny.
Then goes tromping around wearing boots like Gaston.
I'm sorry, okay? I had to. It was right there. Gaston was a secretary to King Louis XIV's, yes, the Sun King himself is in this story, master of the horse, Count d'Armagnac. I know I'm mispronouncing these things, okay? I'm really trying my hardest. Master of the Horse, also known as Grand Squire of France, was one of seven great officers to the Crown of France beginning in 1595. He was also the headmaster of the royal stables, as the name implies. Couldn't find who her mom was. Though Julie was not born into nobility, she was raised around them. Since her father worked for the Master of the Horse, he had the title of Keeper of the King's Stables, which I really want that title. So she grew up mainly in the great stables. For me, that wouldn't be such a bad rap. I would actually wouldn't mind growing up in a grand king's stables. Now, though Julie's father was a habitual gambler, drinker, and did nightlife activities, he was a master swordsman. When Julie was 9 in 1682, she and her father moved to the Palace of Versailles.
Yes!
When her father got a job training the king's squires, who are young boys training to be knights. This is where her father is awesome. While other noble women around Julie were wearing those enormous dresses that couldn't fit through a door and doing classes in etiquette, embroidery, sewing, and other ungodly boring things, Julie was trained right alongside her father's trainees in the art of fencing, horseback riding, gambling, and even given an education that was only meant for boys during that time. Due to that grand idea by her father, she was proficient in courtly education, mainly reading, writing, drawing, dancing, and singing. By the time she was 12, she was competing against grown men in fencing and defeating them. Because of all this, by the time she was in her teenage years, she was an expert swordswoman. And since she was already being raised around them, Julie decided to dress like a boy. She would even wear men's clothing in public, but surprisingly, this didn't raise many eyebrows, as many would think it would back in those times. But hold on, little history geek coming out here, but this is relevant, I promise you. The reason Julie didn't get many looks was that King Louis's brother was a notorious cross-dresser. Remember him for later. So at least in King Louis XIV's court, there was more of a do you boo attitude when it came to traditional fashion choices. Okay, this is where things get very... When Julie was 14 or 15, she became the mistress of her father's boss, Count Louis d'Aubignac, who was 46. Ew. Again, different times. It's still just... This is where we don't like this d'Aubignac guy. Not wanting to lose respectability, Louis over here arranged, but we'll really say forced, Julie to marry a minor noble to cover up the affair. Yeah, we don't like him no more. In 1687, Julie married Sieur Dane Maupin of... I'm gonna let the robot say this one.
Saint-Germain-en-Laye.
They're... Oh, loud noises of dropping things.
Loud noises!
Therefore, giving her the title of Madame de Maupin, or simply La Maupin. Unfortunately, in that same year, Julie's father died, and I'm not sure too unfortunate for Julie. Her husband got an administrative position in the south of France, but Julie was left behind for his own purposes. Whatever that means. Now, we don't exactly know if Julie either became tired of her husband's ways or if she just got bored with him overall. I think it was a combination of, you know, being a mistress at 14, forced marriage, father dying, and overall demeanor of this sucks, that she fell for one of the most prominent swordsmen in the court, Serres. I couldn't find the last name, and if I mispronounced that wrong, I'm sorry. It has this little thing on the E, so I'm just... In English, it said Serres. And in French, it was like Serens, and I'm like, I'm not doing that. My throat already hurts. Now, important note here. Dueling, or better known as duels of honor, became illegal in 1566 by Charles IX because dueling was everywhere and, you know, people were dying a lot. And being in a duel was punishable by death. So, when Serres killed a man in an illegal duel, Lieutenant General of Police Gabriel Nicolas de la Reyne, who is considered to be the founder of the first modern police force, wanted to arrest him, as you should when you kill somebody in a way that is illegal. Just saying. But not wanting that stress, he and Julie fled Paris. Classic Romeo and Juliet move. While traveling, they lived in poverty. The couple went town to town in the south of France, earning money by doing fencing demonstrations, which apparently is different from a duel, but we're just gonna go with it. And they would sing in taverns and local fairs, because not only did Julie have a good voice, but apparently her boyfriend did too. Now, Julie did continue to wear men's clothes, but didn't attempt to pass as a male. This is funny. Before every duel, Julie would sing a song about how weak they were before she defeated them. And since, you know, dueling was mainly men, that meant she sang a song about how weak the men were before she defeated the men. During a demonstration, a man didn't believe she was a woman because she was too skilled in fencing. Just because you got these does not mean you're not skilled in the same thing that a man can do. So, allegedly, but I completely buy it, in response to this guy, she took her shirt off. This one's gonna be fun. I'm just telling you. I'm gonna have so much fun with this chick. Okay, how do you pronounce this place? When they got to the city of Marseille, it was there where Julie had her first experience with professional opera singing. Though she has no formal training, her singing voice was pleasing. I don't really quite know what that means. And her natural gift for music and physical attractiveness enabled her to get roles at the recently founded Opera de Marseille, an opera house in Marseille. Interestingly, a lack of formal musical education that would be needed and necessary today wasn't a hindrance for a successful opera career at that time. And her natural singing, acting, and amazing memory compensated for her inexperience. Because if you've ever seen an opera, I don't know how you remember all these words. It was during this time her whirlwind romance with Ceres ended, but at the same time she became a star of the Marseille Opera House, mainly as a soprano, and then became one of the first opera's contralto singers. Contralto vocalists have the lowest voice range of female singers. For men, this range is known as countotenor. I know that's a really weird word. Using La Maupin as her stage name, she performed as many legendary women in history, including Medea, not that one, this one, a Greek mythology sorceress, which, let me know if you want me to do a video about her. She's fascinating, and plus I love Greek myths, so yeah, I would love to do a story on Greek myths stuff. Diana, again, not that one, this one, a goddess in Roman and Hellenistic religion, and Pallas Athena. I hope to Zeus, we all know who Athena is, but the name Pallas she took as a sign of her grief after her childhood friend by the name of Pallas was killed by Athena after a friendly sparring match. Which, that's kind of ironic. The only reason that Julie is playing this Athena role is because of a deadly sparring match that Julie didn't do, her idiot boyfriend did, but still. Anyway. Julie's riveting performances attracted the attention of many, most notably the attention of a young woman. This would be her first lesbian relationship. We don't know the young woman's name, but we do know that they were truly in love. Now, before I get into this, let me remind you, this is the 16th, 17th century. So same-sex love was a huge no. Like, it was illegal in France at this time, and in other places it was illegal by punishment of death. But still interesting to me, cross-dressing itself wasn't illegal. It was still immoral and inappropriate. However, at the same time, men wore heels, makeup, crazy elaborate clothing, and had long-haired wigs as a sign of wealth and class. Having said that, the family of this young woman sent her away to a convent. Wow, possibly the
Visitandine. Visitandine.
Yeah, no.
Visitandine.
Convent in Avignon, a city in southeastern France, to stop contact with Julie and to save their daughter's soul. It's okay. I'm breathing, you're breathing. It's fine. Different times, different okays. According to several sources on Julie's life, she wasn't gonna give up her lover that easily. So, and I'm just gonna be honest with you now, this is where it gets weird. Really, really freaking weird. Julie joined the convent, posing as a postulant or a candidate as a nun to get into the convict to join her lover. Oh, man. Once they were back together, they wanted to escape. So, in order to do this, oh, I don't like this at all. Look, I'm not gonna sugarcoat this, so I'm just gonna say it. I don't know if it was both of them or one of them or what. They dug up the body of a dead nun, put it in the bed of Julie's lover, set the convent on fire, and dipped. I swear I'm not making this up. But if you think about it, because of course I did, they got the body and they set the convent on fire to hopefully throw off a search for the girl, because when they found the body, they would assume that Julie's lover burned in the fire and she was dead from the fire. Makes sense to me. Now, I don't know if this was all worth it, because the relationship ended 3 months later when the young woman went back to her family. Can you imagine? You join a convent to be with your lover, same sex or not. You dig up the body of a nun, put it into her bed, and light a convent on fire. And then 3 months later, she dumps you to go back to her family. Perspective. This makes no sense. When the breakup happened, Julie took some time to focus on herself, which I hope she would after doing all that, and had professional singing lessons with instructor Marcello. I know I mispronounced that, okay? I know that. I looked it up. It's hard. He was so impressed by her talent that he encouraged her to apply to the Paris Opera, which is the greatest opera stage in France. And I'm pretty sure when I was in Paris, I went there. If I can find the photo of me, I'll put it right here. I'm 95% sure I actually saw the thing. It's immaculate, on the outside at least. I wasn't rich enough to go inside there anyway. I've seen that thing. Now, I'm just gonna call him Chal. Now, Chal was a great teacher, but he was also fond of the bottle. And when he drank, he couldn't teach that good for the obvious reasons. So Julie left him to seek her fame in Paris. On her way to Paris, she literally ran into Charles Delbert, a French courtier who is essentially a royal companion or advisor to the king or queen, and who was a favorite of Louis XIII. And according to many accounts, this dude was so offended by the fact that she accidentally ran into him that he immediately challenged her to a duel. Even though it's illegal, but whatever, moving on. Not only did Julie win the duel, she stabbed through, not in, through his shoulder with her sword. And I'm gonna assume that she's saying about his defeat. Okay, she felt remorse, right? Of course she felt remorse because she stabbed him through the shoulder. I really didn't think that she meant to stab him through the shoulder. So the next day, she went to check on him. Apparently, she made a pretty good impression because she ended up seducing him and they became lovers for like 7, 8, 9 months. Now, they ultimately became just friends and it became a lifelong friendship. Look, I don't know what's going on either, okay? I don't know what's going on anymore either. Don't worry though, she wouldn't be single for long. This girl can get around. She began a relationship with fellow singer Gabriel Vincent Thevenard. We're ignoring this weird hat. At the time Julie met him, he just so happened to be auditioning for the Paris Opera, and Julie quickly convinced him to get her an audition. Supposedly, the opera house was hesitant at first to have her audition, but they did give her an audition, and once they heard her voice, Julie was quickly hired. But there's one tiny problem. Remember when she burned down that convent? Well, the Parliament of Aix-en-Provence sentenced Julie in absentia. Basically, she didn't show up to court. She was charged with kidnapping, body snatching, arson, and of course, failing to appear before court. She was tried as a male and sentenced to death by fire. That's different. I truly don't know how this happened, but she got with her old lover, Louis de Maillac, and somehow got him to get King Louis to give her a pardon, which was granted. And her debut Paris opera performance was as Pallas Athena in Cadmus et Hermione by Jean-Baptiste Lully in December of 1690 at the age of 17. Let's pause for a minute here. At just 17, she's already been a mistress, married, ran away with a lover twice, dug up a dead nun, set a convent on fire, got a pardon from a king, and is now an official opera singer at one of the most famous opera houses in the world. Wow. She continued to perform for Paris Opera from 1690 to 1694, first singing as a soprano, then moved into her more natural contralto range. Felipe de Cortelon, a French officer and author, wrote in his journal about one of Julie's performances in Omphale in 1701 that her voice was, quote, the most beautiful voice in the world, end quote. She worked with many composers in her career. One with Henry de Mahé, performing in his debut opera of Dido in 1693 as a female magician. She quickly became a staple of Paris high society and had many public affairs with co-stars, both men and women. I swear she must have been a Scorpio because this chick got into a lot of fights. For example, one of many. She publicly confronted an actor who was sexually harassing many female company members. When the guy wouldn't relent, she just beat him up. I just get that energy from her. She loved confrontation. Her reputation for being a, quote, wild woman was so well known that people flocked to the opera just to see her. Soon, her tales of achievement reached her childhood home of Versailles. Let's just really quickly pause here. Can you imagine that your childhood home is the Palace of Versailles? That's a flex. And she was invited to a royal ball as a personal guest of Felipe d'Orléans, the cross-dressing brother of King Louis XIV. See, I told you he would come back. Remember him? Yep. Julie, not one to pass up an opportunity like this, arrived dressed as a man. Yes. She proceeded to dance with many of the women at the ball, married and single. In fact, again, she's unapologetically Julie. Without a care in the world, passionately kissed a very famous single noble woman. This upset three men that wanted to kiss this woman first. So what did they do? They did what any man would do. They challenged Julie to a duel. Yeah. That's what a man does. I'm gonna fight you because I wanted to do that first. Reportedly, she basically said, bet, let's take this outside. In a 3-to-1 duel, she beat them all, leaving them with many stab wounds to lick. I love her. And returned to the party as if nothing happened. I'm assuming she returned like this. Now, this would have been awesome gossip if it wasn't for the fact that dueling, remember, is illegal. I'm telling you, big Scorpio energy. So, Julie had broken the law again. Plus, this time, she broke the law in the king's court as a guest of the king's brother. That's a big oops. Again, not wanting to deal with the stress of facing her consequences, Julie fled to Brussels, Belgium. Okay, break time. My mouth needs to reset from all these French words. When we come back, Julie is in Brussels, evading the law. Great. My mouth hurts from pretending to sound French. Okay, we are back. We are in Brussels. It is 1697. Julie kept her singing career going by appearing at the, I am seriously not going to even try,
Opéra du Quai au Foin,
which was the first public theater to open in Brussels on January 10th, 1682. Then in 1897, it was abandoned and turned into a warehouse. I don't like how that ended. An opera house should not be turned into a warehouse. You would think that with her being in Brussels, escaping persecution, that Julie would dial back her behavior. Well, as we've established, this is Julie. And I probably wouldn't be talking about her if she had been well behaved. During her time at the opera house, Julie was still being Julie. During a suicide scene in Johann Wolfgang Frank's Aeneas, she intentionally stabbed herself with a dagger. Okay. And, of course, not one to be single for very long, had a relationship with Maximilian II Emmanuel. I'm pretty sure that's where you put the second in that name. The Elector of Bavaria. The romance was short-lived, couldn't exactly find how it ended, but some say that either Emmanuel got tired of Julie or just couldn't handle her,
really don't blame him,
and tried to pay her off. 10,000 francs payoff money, which is about 45,000 in US dollars. Now, I can't give you an exact amount in francs because records and inflation data don't go back this far. I'm sure, as any woman would be, Julie was infuriated by this and threw the money in his face and went back to Paris. You're gonna try and pay me off? Here's that money back and I'm going to Paris. That's an awesome move. But hold on, you might be thinking, the dueling charge, she's gonna get arrested. Don't worry about that. By the time Julie got back to Paris in mid-1698, Felipe had convinced his brother to pardon her. Yep, she got a pardon by the king twice in under 10 years, and she's 25. We're moving on. How do you get a pardon by the king twice? I'm just asking that. She resumed her opera career at Paris Opera just as opera star
Marie La Rochois
retired in 1698. This paved the way for Julie to get more leading roles, and she reached her operatic career peak between 1698 and 1705. Where'd the thingy go? Fudge me. Her first role after returning was in Vesey in November of 1698 in the role of Minerve. I know I mispronounced that, okay? I'm trying really hard. One of her most notable performances was as the Greek goddess of agriculture and fertility Ceres in the 1699 show of Persephone. She even performed in the court of Versailles many times. In 1702, she had the honor of having an opera written exclusively for her by André Capret himself. I want to know how you get so awesome that you get an opera written for yourself. Julie kept pushing the boundaries of, well, everything. She kept getting into duels, had fist fights, and had a fling with her ex, this guy, and got mad at him about something and bit his ear in a performance where she drew blood and threatened to beat up her landlord. Telling you, Scorpio energy. On the crazy side, but Scorpio energy. Her insane behavior aside, Julie performed over 24 stage productions, not only operas, but in concerts and opera ballets, which I really want to see one day. She worked with many famous composers, not only with Capra, but also with André Carnel de Touche and Pascal Callas. She originated 25 roles for the opera and had many existing roles that were sometimes rewritten to fit her lower vocal range. Most female opera singers with the soprano range have the roles of gentle, meek, more feminine roles, but Julie's vocal range, though in the soprano range, was much lower, so she excelled at the roles of goddesses and female warriors. Though some biographers say that she did trouser roles or male characters, all her known characters she performed as were female. And I'm pretty sure I don't have to say this, but just because you wear pants doesn't always mean it's a male role. I'm just saying, some warriors and goddesses in history wore freaking pants. Mulan did. In real life and in the Disney movie. Her most significant role for the Paris Opera was in 1702 in a collaboration with Capra in Tancredi, which is thought to have been the first opera with a bas de six, or
contralto
voice in a leading role in French opera. There's conflicting accounts as to if it is true, but it is very clear this is to have been the first French opera where the leading female role was not a soprano. Capra wrote the leading role, Clorinde, specifically for Julie. Thought to be her most famous role was as Médée in Médès by François Bovard. She got the role last minute when the original pick of Mademoiselle de Maddens got sick. Now, this is one of the most difficult roles Julie ever had, so it was no surprise that with Julie's ability to sing and her phenomenal memory, that she received high praise for her role and pushed her into the history books, or Herstory books, I should say. Julie's wildness would eventually settle down. There are two variant accounts as to what exactly happened. Either she reconnected with her husband, Sieur de Mappin. Yeah, she's still technically married, and she continued her career at Paris Opera. Or, and I personally buy this one much more, she fell madly in love with Madame la Marquise de La Fransec, known as the most beautiful woman in France, and they lived openly as a couple for many years. Her last performance was as Isabelle in La Vengeance by the famous flute player Michel de Lebras. He was known as a more instrumental opera composer. This was her last role because, unfortunately, during the opera's run, her lover fell ill and died 2 days later from a fever on July 2nd, 1705. As with anyone, Julie was inconsolable and went into a deep depression. So she retired from the opera. Now, this is where the conflicting accounts come in even more. Supposedly, it was after her lover passed and she had left the opera that she then connected with her husband and lived out the rest of her days, or she joined a convent and lived out the rest of her days. There's even conflicting accounts on exactly when she died, age-wise. Let me explain. If you go the husband route, she died in 1707 at the age of 37 from an unknown cause. Or if you go the nun route, she still died in 1707, but at the age of 33 from a fever.
Okay. Blech.
That was the story of Julie, truly a woman who was unapologetically her. And she is inspiring to me in so many ways, mainly because when I first saw this photo of her, I was like, this is gonna be fun. And I think we can all learn to embrace ourselves from just her being her and do not be well behaved, because she wasn't well behaved, and look at her, she made history. But like, don't dig up a nun and burn down a convent. Don't do anything illegal, but just be you, and you might just make history. If you learned something today, please like, share, and subscribe to this channel. And while you're down there, please leave a friendly comment. I will be back next week with another video. And until then, just like Julie, do not be well behaved. You will make Herstory. See you next time, guys.